last session of the day. So between us and beers, we have Hardik, and he's going to talk a little bit about hardening Kubernetes infrastructure.
Hello, good evening. I'm Hardik Vyas. I work for Red Hat, the product security team. Thank you for being here, especially the last session. I hope it's not too much Kubernetes and letting go of the beer and giving preference to this session. Thank you so much. So, as we all know, Kubernetes adoption is increasing day by day. And it's not just specific to the IT industry, but it's also increasing the non-IT ecosystem, right? So with the increased production workload and data moving to the Kubernetes clusters, and the more reliant we become on the Kubernetes, right? So it's very crucial to keep the Kubernetes environment safe and secure, just not to put the enterprise at risk, right? So in this presentation, we are going to see a couple of challenges and strategies for system administrators and developers to mitigate the risk they might face during the Kubernetes deployment or when running Kubernetes environments. So the secure configuration guidance is based on the recent NSA and CISA guidelines. So the agenda and the content here correlates to the NSA and CSI guidelines. So before we proceed, I'll just briefly summarize what we are going to talk about in this session. So the very first agenda item is pod and container security. So before I proceed, just let me quickly put a disclaimer. We are not going to be in so detail about what is pod and what is node and the resources, like Marco did it a while back, right? So we are just assuming we all know what are the basic resources and the policies, right? Based on that assumption, we'll just have a quick overview of what are the best hardening security practices over here. So yeah, the pod and container security. In this item, we'll talk about running and deploying pod containers with the least privileges possible, and the importance of scanning pod containers regularly for the known vulnerabilities and misconfigurations, followed with network separation. So network separation basically to control the damage, the amount of damage and compromise can cause, right? And for instance, the system is compromised and we are having a proper network separation, network segmentation in place, we can control the amount of damage an attacker can cause to the system. Authentication and authorization would be another point of, I would say, into the security hardening practices that again follows the same principle of least privileges possible. Basically limiting users and accounts, administrators, the minimum amount of privilege required just to perform their operation and not to provide unnecessary privileges just to extend the sort of like surface area for the attack, right? So we are just basically reducing the, limiting the surface area here for the attack with the proper authentication and authorization in place. We'll discuss RBAC stuff here. And of course, log auditing. So capturing logs and not just capturing, monitoring it so that the administrators, system administrators can be alerted of any potential malicious activity on the system, if at all, right? So this is one of the very crucial part. And yeah, the rest of the security practices, which we'll see, patching and whatnot. So starting with the pod security and pod and container security. So Kubernetes by default do not provide strict workload isolation between running pods in the same node and in the same cluster, right? So however, we do have a few techniques to evolve the existing isolation techniques to reduce the attack surface area here. And it's quite like pods are quite often cyber actors' initial execution environment upon exploiting the containers. So it's very crucial, it's very important to harden the pod to make the exploit as difficult as we can and to limit the impact and compromise can cause to the system. So the very first item here is like security context. In terms of pods and containers. So here are a few list of security contexts I have listed here. So the complete list of security contexts are a bit huge. You can find it over here. So these are basically security contexts can be applied at both pod as well as the container manifest as well. And say run as user or run as group, if we have implemented both security contexts at say pod level as well as manifest, so they can. The one which we have mentioned at the container level will take the precedence. Let's understand this security context with the YAML. This is just an illustration purpose. Here you can see like run as user and run as group, which is also mentioned in the spec of pod, and this is also in the manifest of the container, right? So run as root in the container is with 3000 ID, and run as user is 2000. So in this case, the latter will take precedence. So when we say run as root, so let's discuss this first three, like what is run as root? We are just trying to have our containers running as non-root containers. That's something we want to establish here. Because by default, many applications containers are running with root containers, right? Which is really not required. Some might require for genuine purpose, but most of times, if applications really need not have to run as root containers, it's a best practice to not run as root, right? So specifically define the user, what user you want that application to run with, right? So this is an example of runtime, right? So we are defining these users, these groups in runtime, but it is recommended to have such configuration at the build time itself, at the Docker file, right? So we'll see in the further slides how we can do that and during the image sections. So the good practice here is like in the Docker file itself, one should define what user is supposed to have access to the container, the application, right? So we can run with the same. This way we are reducing the impact, right? I guess you understand. Just having that user specifically mentioned over there and no other user will have access to it. So yeah, non-root containers, that's one of the recommendation. Another is like, okay, privileged and allow privilege escalation, these two are interrelated. So privilege mode is something like this is disabled by default, but if enabled, the processes in this privileged container mode, right, the processes will run similar as root. We have on the whole systems, right? So those are unnecessarily running as privileged if we are not required to run with those superpowers. If those superpowers are not required, it's suggested to not run container as a privileged mode, right? So rather just disable, let it be disabled and have it run, like add the privileges, we'll see capabilities and whatnot in the later part. and specifically add it for the specific operation that the application is supposed to do, right? The after privilege, it's like allow privilege escalation, it is interrelated, it gets enabled, like, it has two conditions. Number one, the privilege, the container is running as a privileged container, and it could also be enabled like when we are having the system sysadmin capabilities on the spec file, right? So that's where it gets enabled here. The privilege escalation is nothing but it provides processes running in the container to gain more privileges than these for parent process, right? So that's the purpose of this privilege escalation security context. So if there is no such use case for the service into the container, then let's have it disabled. We are just narrowing down the scope of it, right? Okay, so the next one is read-only file system. So the read-only file system, we are trying to make our container like immutable, right? So by default, containers are permitted sort of like write access. For example, if you are just having a container running, right? So it's having a root, as in like write access for it. So, and if application is just in read-only mode, the application is not supposed to write onto the root file system, then it's recommended to have it disabled. But yes, there are applications that do require some write operations to be performed on the system. In such cases, it is good idea to have pentest into the picture, or is have a secondary volume mounted where the application can be application can write the perform the write operation at the another mount. For example, here is the writable location we have provided. The read only root file system is enabled, and but the application can perform the write operation, write activities at that area, the different secondary location here, or the tender first, right? So, yeah. So, how is this is useful, right? So, let's assume if an attacker is able to get into the system, so with the root access, like with the root write access enabled, attacker can download the scripts, right? He can write its own, he can create files, he can modify applications. So, yeah, that's a huge risk. So, if not required, just go ahead and disable it. If required, follow the approach of having some secondary mount point where we can enable the operation of the application. And the last, capabilities. So capabilities is something like providing some privilege, a privileged access to a process to perform some privileged operation without providing root level of access, without giving a complete root level access to that, right? So if I'm supposed to have some sort of like net admin sort of access for it, so we can manually define it and drop all the unnecessary capabilities. So these are the similar to Linux capabilities what we have, right? So we are dropping all the capabilities here, and just to be like specifically mentioning the capabilities what we want our application, what we want our container to have it on, right? So this is an instance. Okay. So yeah, security context plays a major role here in meeting the goal of least privileges possible. You can further narrow down the scope accordingly. And protecting pods, service accounts. So by default, Kubernetes mounts the service accounts in the pod. Few of the applications use this service account tokens to get authenticated with the external services and whatnot. That's why. If it's required, that's good. We can implement the RBAC policies to further tighten the security here. But if it's not required, if these security tokens are not going to be used further, so it's not a good idea to just have it auto-mounted over there. So, as you can see in this page file, the second option, auto-mount service account token, let's have it false over there. By default, it mounts it. Defining it false, it won't mount the token specifically over there. Memory and CPU, yeah. So this has mostly to do with the, let's take a scenario where we are like, there's an insider threat or some malicious actor who is able to exhaust the memory resources or the CPU resources on the system, right? So this can create a situation of either a partial denial of service or denial of service where due to the lack of CPU and memory, legit processes might starve for the resources, right? They are not able to perform their operation. If it's a web server, the page is not getting enough memory required to operate. So we are just down, the web server is down, right? So a sort of denial of service attack, those sort of attacks can be performed here if we are not having proper memory and CPU limitations on set on the system. So it's suggested to have the caps defined, of course. That will require prior testing on the test bed, how much memory or CPU your application needs to perform in a as expected situation, right? So this can be done via admission controller, where we have limit ranges that can be set at the pod container level. We have resource quotas for namespaces level that we can define specifically what all limits and range we have. We have to have these max and minimum limits, right? So let's have a look at a spec file here, pod spec file, where we are just following an approach of like, you can see the limits and requests. These are the two important fields. Under the resource, we have limits and requests. So you can say like soft and hard limits, right? So the request is of 50 MB here, and the limit is of 100 MB, which means like the pod has guaranteed a 50 MB of memory for their operation. But it doesn't mean like just the 50 MB. If the service is gonna request, say I want 52 MB, the pod is gonna look out for the available memory if it has already, and is going to provision that memory if that's a feasible option, right? But that's not gonna cross the limit of 100 MB. So 100 MB is the hard limit, that's it. And if pod is having memory after giving the 100 MB as well, the next request won't be fulfilled, right? So 50 MB and 100. So this way we can have, same way we can have for CPU as well, number of CPU cycles and whatnot. So yeah, it's good practice to have these limits set on the system to ensure we are not being prone to any sort of like DOS attacks and whatnot, just due to the CPU and memory exhaust issues. Yeah, so before we proceed, like the SecCom, App Armor, and the C Linux, to my knowledge, they are just limited to the Linux nodes, right? SecCom is a tool to basically limit containers. There's a system call capabilities. We can limit it, and this tool is disabled, so it's a good idea. So it by default, it can be configured with profiles. It comes with three different profiles, unconfined, and some runtime default profile. And we have an option to provide our custom. We have an option to write our custom profile as well and provide to the localhost path here. So yes, basically, this further narrow down the scope. If you want to sort of like provide restrictions at the system call levels, so SecCom is the good way where we can limit the container capabilities, system call capabilities here. We are not going deep into this tool. It's just a sort of like the available options that we can explore. App Armor, similar to SecCom, has like you can configure App Armor through different profiles it provides. So App Armor is basically a Linux kernel security module. It mainly deals with the mandatory access controls on the system. So the profiles that App Armor provides are basically, they run basically in the two modes, like enforcing and compliant mode. Enforcing means something that the profile, for example, we have a set of rules defined in the profile that restrict couple of resources, right? If the enforcing mode is on, those resources will be blocked from the access. If compliant mode is on, the App Armor will just be providing a violation report, right? That okay, someone has tried to access the resource which was sort of like prohibited, right? But the operation will still be carried out. SC Linux, same as App Armor, it is also a Linux kernel security module. And basically, it can be configured in the security context with the desired labels over there. And it can be configured at the pod and container level, like App Armor can also be configured at the pod level. So yeah, these are the basic like tools that one can explore to further tighten the security of the system. And the pod security standard policies. So with the recent versions, we have pod security admission that deprecates the PSP, which is pod security policy, and it provides the straightforward, very straightforward way of implementation than the PSP, right? So pod security is admission control is disabled by default. So it comes with different several profiles, baseline profile, restricted profile, and the privileged profile. Privileged, so privileged profile is something that we are giving the privileged superpower access to the existing resources, user which are going to access it. Baseline is the balanced profile, and restricted is the most restricted set of rules, where with the help of it, user has like it limits the way a security context can be modified further, right? So yeah, it's enabled by default, and further we'll see images in the next slides. So yeah. So it's suggested to have the only required content. We have seen like the time of building images, we are just building the image as it is. Like it's not a good practice. So the suggested practice is like if you know your software, you know what dependencies your software requires, right? So just try to stick to the scratch. Try to build from the scratch and have your dependencies mentioned over there, what all dependencies you have in the top of file. And you are there. If that's not feasible option, there are also bare minimum base images available that has very less number of, I would say, dependencies third-party dependencies or indirect dependencies over there that sometimes our application do not use, but they still reside over here. So what's the risk with it, right? So if there's something that we are not using it, but we are still shipping it over there, so that's just like, in future, if there's any security issue and we are not going to update it, so that might directly or indirectly pose a risk to our environment, right? So it's good practice to either have it from scratch or have it from the bare base, bare minimal base range. So that's something I would suggest. And the other option is like always pull the latest image, provided, yeah, of course, the trusted repositories. Always pull from the repository that you trust, and it's sort of like, and the best practice is like pulling the latest images. So there is an admission controller as well, which is like always pull images. If that's enabled, like it will ensure that the latest images are getting pulled over there, right? So those are having the latest security patches into the system for the base image dependencies which are coming with it. And yeah, like I mentioned a while back, having the in the topic of non-root containers, right? So this is where in the Docker file you can specifically call out for a user, what group you want to have this container for, and this way we are just having it hard-coded into it, right? Rather than just depending on the runtime, which is also fine, but this is much better, I would say. Let's have it hard-coded with the username and avoid running container as root container. Moving to the next topic, which is network separation and hardening. So one of the major benefits of network segmentation is like attacking the limiting the attack surface here. So by default, Kubernetes resources are not isolated. No network policies are applied to pods or namespaces, resulting in a sort of like unrestricted traffic between pod and namespaces, right? Because the traffic is not restricted. Increase and increase traffics, those are like, right, open. And yeah, so network policies can be very useful here. So what exactly the network policies do? Network policies control the flow of increase and egress traffic between the pods, namespaces, and external IPs. So one can create network policies with the help of network plugins, example CNAP. Also there are a few web GUI tools available that can help you design the network policies over there, right? And as a best security practice, it is recommended to administrators to have the default policy applied for all the pods, denying all the ingress and egress traffic, and define a separate network policy to just allow permissible connections that will provide relaxation to the application what we are running over there, right? So we'll quickly go through this snippets over here. So the network policy snippet at the leftmost side limits access to the Nginx service to pods which are with the label of access, right? So if you see spec pod selector, it's for the app Nginx, and there's an ingress policy rule here where pod selector matches only the pods they are having a label access over there. So this way we are just enabling ingress traffic for this Nginx service via this configuration. And at the same time, we are disabling all the ingress and egress policy in the configuration. As you can see, the metadata name says deny all ingress, and the spec is like pod select everything, right? So all the pods are selected over here, and policy type is ingress, and here the policy type is egress. So we are denying every ingress and egress traffic, but just allowing the ingress to these pods who have this label access set to it. So this is a good way of isolating our network resources, right? And yeah, control plane, I'll jump to the control plane, which is sort of like another crucial component of Kubernetes. Like it has HTTPD, it has workloads, it has storage, authentication, and whatnot. So that being said, like, it's very critical to ensure that we are having separate network for this control plane. The encryption and transit is enabled for these communication in the control plane, and we are having the least possible access provided for the users available on the system. So a proper implementation of RBAC should be done here to provide access to these resources only to the users there, who really require access to the control plane, or else it's a good idea to just drop access to them and let's have the control plane in the control mode. HTCD, like for example, HTCD.
That's kind of already over time.
Yeah, you just make it quick. Yeah. Sorry for that. Just last point over here. The HTCD, as you know, it contains secrets, right? And the secrets are valid for like into base64 encoding. So here, HTCD data store is not encrypted by default. It's disabled. So it's strongly suggested to enable the encryption over the HTCD database here to ensure that our secrets are being encrypted. By default, those are like base64 encoding here. And of course, the follow up practice of storing secrets in the Kubernetes secret resource and not just in the config maps or your configuration files, right? I'll make it really quick, like authentication and authorization.
Pardon? You have like 1 minute.
So use of like it's suggested to use strong authentication methods. Do not store passwords into the just static files, right? And ensure we have RBAC policies enabled over there. Only the permission which is required to perform the operation is there. Avoid the use of wildcards when defining verbs, right? That's very hazardous. Like avoid using star. I would prefer manually mentioning the verbs what you really want, specifically when you create roles, cluster roles, and then later map it to the role bindings and cluster role bindings, right? Once you have roles and once you have a user, if you are providing a user a cluster role binding where it was really wasn't required to have cluster level of binding over there, but so such sort of like wise decisions should be taken. And I would adding user to the system master group because system master group will decline all the RBAC stuffs. Yeah, done. So log auditing and
we have to stop.
Yeah, that's fine.
Show the last slide, please.
So yeah, last slide is like, okay, just ensure we have latest patches on the system, ensure we don't have outdated libraries on the system, so those are like risk to the system. Yeah. Thank you. Sorry.